The opinions expressed in this program are not necessarily those of this station, the USD Department of Media and Journalism, or the University of South Dakota.
You're listening to KAOR, Vermilion, South Dakota.
The CharCole Sports Show. The hottest names and the hottest takes.
Tune in every Wednesday from 6 to 7 p.m. where Charlie Prien and Cole Larsch highlight prep sports, college sports, Coyote athletics, and professional sports. We would love to hear your questions for us, too. The phone lines are always open.
Tune in to the CharCole Sports Show each Wednesday from 6 to 7 p.m. to hear the hottest takes on KAOR Vermilion.
Good evening, everyone. It's the CharCole Sports Show, Wednesday, February 21st, 2024. Thanks for tuning in to the 21st edition of the CharCole Sports Show. Big show, so buckle up. First, it's USD basketball, where the women bounced back after an awful loss on Thursday and got a good win on Saturday, and the men took two tough losses. Then we're going to move on to quite a bit of South Dakota high school sports talk. First, we'll start off with the recent media poll and the playoff results from the past week. Next, we're going to talk about the proposed alignments for many of the sports, which will probably bring up some controversy. Finally, it's the recent talking point of high school sports attendance. Is it going up or down? What might be causing it? We will discuss that. As always, we end with our picks of the week. Feel free to call in at any time, especially the 625 and 635 segments. That phone number is 605-658-6813. Again, we will always answer the phones. Buckle in, because the CharCole Sports Show starts right now.
And welcome to this 21st edition of the CharCole Sports Show. I'm Charlie Prien, joined by Cole Larsch. Cole, I would say this is the most anticipated show that we have ever done together, simply because we got into the studio so early today.
True. If I turn on my microphone, there we go. Yeah, true, I agree.
Pretty funny stuff there. Get into the office, if you will, a little bit sooner than usual today.
First time for everything, right?
Yeah, I suppose. Sat here for a while and talked about some random stuff, but got a lot of great stuff on the docket for you today. Again, if you want to call in at any point to the CharCole Sports Show, the number 605-658-6813 to call into the CharCole Sports Show. At any time you can call in. We should answer the phone. If not, try again, because the phone line is working. We tried this before the show started, so.
Very true.
All right, well, let's get into our first segment of the day. We're going to try to roll through this one. If we can, Cole, yes.
Breaking news regarding the most recent segment they're about to bring into the USD Coyote Sports. Per the USD SID women's basketball game notes, assistant coach Mike Jewett will serve as the acting head coach on the sidelines for this road trip, as USD head coach Kayla Carius has travel restrictions due to the approaching due date of her child. So Mike Jewett back on the sidelines. He was on the sidelines the past two games. In place of that, went 1-1.
Great use of breaking news in this segment, Cole.
Yeah, for some reason, there we go. Now I can hear myself. There, what a deal. For some reason, we always start off the show with breaking news. Doesn't matter what week it is.
Yeah, it's kind of goofy, isn't it?
It's it's crazy how that thing works out.
Something else. Well, we're going to get into women's basketball here at the University of South Dakota. The Coyotes, Cole, 18-9 overall and 7-5 in the Summit.
Yes, they are. Their last two games, Thursday, 6 p.m. against Omaha here in the SCSC. I was in attendance. For lack of better terms, a bad loss, as they lost to the Omaha Mavericks 77-67. Great game for Kendall Holm, though, 21 points. Again, Omaha came into that game 1-10 in the Summit League as the bottom team.
Yeah, it truly was an upset, Cole. I watched it and did the board for that one, and it just felt like we started slow, and we stayed there, and we just played with their pace after a little while, but we just were consistently down. We got to, what, 5-7 points, maybe, at the closest we got it, but, I mean, just could not get it close towards the end, and Omaha takes the 10-point victory, and they were very, very proud of themselves after the game. I mean, I watched their whole team pretty much celebrate just before they got into the handshake line, but I mean,
yeah,
they were jacked about that thing. Huge win for Omaha.
Yeah, it was. I'm trying to look. The game was only tied once, and it was right away when it was 3-3 was the only time it was tied. I believe at one point Omaha made it pretty close to a 12-point ball game. 17-8 would have been one of the bigger leads, and that's just kind of how it sat the entire game. So
yeah, it really couldn't get anything going from the perimeter. I'd say that was the big thing.
Yeah, that was probably one of the bigger deals, and it just seemed like we let Omaha shoot whatever they wanted to, and they seemed to be hitting the shots. Looking at the Summit League standings, SDSU still number one at 12-0, NDSU 10-2, Oral Roberts 8-5, USD still in that four spot, so pretty unideal spot, I guess, coming tournament time, as there is only five Summit League games left, I think, four or five, not very many. You want to either be three or five. Three or six. You do not want to be the number four spot because then you have to take on SDSU before the championship. St. Thomas 5, NDSU 6, Denver 7, Kansas City 8. Omaha still down there in last place. They're 2-11 in the conference, with one of those wins being against USD on Thursday. But they were able to bounce back pretty good on Saturday, getting a 75-61 win over the St. Thomas Tommies. Kendall Holmes led scoring with 15 points. It was the pink game. It was a pink out, good recognition before the game as well. A lot of good clips and highlights came from that game as well, just the video clips of everything that they did for that pink game. Good showing in the SDSE as well. Reported attendance was 1,700. I would disagree with that. It seemed like a lot more on Saturday.
I mean, pretty cool atmosphere there for the pink game here. And to have a win is huge, especially with the team coming off a pretty bad loss, Cole. I just don't know. I mean, sometimes teams don't rebound like that. And I think having a 14-point win over the Tommies, a win is a win. And I think this is something that they should be very proud of. But if you look back at the scoring breakdowns, a huge third quarter defensively, only allowed St. Thomas to score 9 points in the third quarter. That kind of sprung them
out. And a lot of them were late, too. Late third quarter points. Next two games for the women. They are at Kansas City and at Oral Roberts. Thursday at 7 p.m. against Kansas City, and Saturday 2 p.m. in Tulsa. Both of them will be on the Summit League network. Again, Kansas City is the second to last team, so you need a win there in the Summit League. And Oral Roberts would be a big game because they're the 3 seed in the Summit. Big game on Saturday, 2 p.m. for the women.
We actually have to have those.
Yes. Big, big games
no,
coming up.
No question. All right, let's move on to the men's side of things. The men's team, Cole, 10-17 overall in 3-9 in the Summit League.
Yeah, it took another couple tough losses against Omaha and against St. Thomas on Thursday and Saturday, as I'm getting the Summit League standings pulled up. On Thursday, 91-84 loss against Omaha. Boston Holt led the way with 22 points. They went down big early and really could not recover at all. And Omaha, when you look at the Summit League standings, is third to last. But then you travel to St. Paul, Minnesota to take on the Tommies, which at one point the Yotes were up again 10 at halftime, 48-38. They could not miss from deep. Also, the reported attendance in that game was 1,509. I'm sure the capacity of that gym is 1,500. That place was slam-packed.
Really?
Yeah. It did not look like a very big gym, and there's a lot of people there, just 1,500. They took a loss 83-80. Had it really close at the end, missed a couple big shots at the end, and St. Thomas just seemed like they couldn't miss for a while. Actually, at one point, I believe they went down close to 10 points in that second half. Again, took a loss 83-80, so they sit at the bottom of the Summit League at 3-9. North Dakota is first. SDSU 2, St. Thomas 3, NDSU and Kansas City tied for fourth. Denver and Omaha tied for sixth. Oral Roberts 8th. And USD 9. It just seems like they can't quite string a good game together. I mean, they come out hot, they go flat in the second half. They come out flat, they go hot in the second half. They just can't pick up these big wins, and you need them coming up.
Yeah, can't pick up big wins, and I just But here's the thing, Cole. When you get into the Summit League tournament, anybody can beat anybody.
True.
So, I mean, as long as you make the tournament, which we're guaranteed to make the tournament.
Yep. And they're already getting written off, too.
I know. I did see that post. So.
So, we'll see.
I think it helps us a little bit, too. But being able to beat Denver and play decently or really close to South Dakota State and St. Thomas, I mean, we're right there with a lot of these. I mean, all of these teams. But there's no team that sticks out right now in the Summit League as far as the men's go, or men's side.
I'd say probably North Dakota.
Right, but I mean, they're only 9-4 in the conference.
Right. That's the thing. It's a pretty balanced at the top conference this year. Two home games coming up on Thursday and Saturday. Thursday at 7 p.m. against Kansas City, the Ruse. That'll be right here on KAOR and also on Midco Sports 1. Not even 2 or anything like that. Saturday, 1 p.m. against Oral Roberts Black History Month celebration inside the SCSC. I'm assuming we'll have that one right here as well on KAOR. Three out of their last four games are at home, and they also are 6-5 at home this year. So see if we can't pick up some big home wins before we travel up to the Denny for the Summit League tournament.
Yeah, I really like to get to some of these last few games. So I'm going to try to make that a note and watch these both men's and women's teams respectively, and hopefully watch them get some wins.
You know, I was thinking the same thing, but just looking at this Thursday or tomorrow, can't. Got games. Saturday, can't. Going up to Brookings, going to go behind enemy lines.
Traitor.
I will be wearing red and a USD hat, so you'll be able to pick me out. Thursday, if the Vermilion girls make it to Sodak 16, can't go to that one. And that Saturday, I'm running board, so I can't even go to that game. I'm 0-4 on these last four games.
Larsh, come on. Well, maybe you'll be able to make the Summit League tournament, because it's about all you got.
Well, the 7th, 8th, and 9th is State A's.
Well, I know.
So that takes out the first 2 days.
You can go to the ending is what matters, though.
True. Yep, that is very true.
So, anyways, Colt, is that everything we want to cover there?
Yeah, I suppose. I mean, we touched on both teams. Women have a good shot to make a big run at it as well.
Yeah, Cole.
I just realized this link is a week old.
No, you're all good. Let's get on to the February 19th. Does it actually work if you do that?
Yep, click on it.
No kidding?
Yep.
Okay.
Ryan Deal is a man of, how should I say this?
Simplicity?
Simplicity or consistency.
Right, there you go.
Just change the numbers from February 12 to February 19, and here is the poll. Very similar to how we voted for it, actually. Let's just kind of run through this quick, and then we'll go through some playoff games. Boys, AA, stop me when you have some notes here, Charlie.
Yep.
Mitchell, 1. Harrisburg, 2. Brandon Valley, 3. Washington, 4. Roosevelt, 5.
Huge win Tuesday night. Mitchell beat Brandon Valley in a packed Corn Palace. I mean, a lot of people there, Cole.
I'd say at least 4,000.
I'd say so, too. I mean, looking at the soft seat sides, I mean, Cole, it's been a long time. Probably prime Dakota Wesleyan days right there.
Right. Exactly. That's exactly what I was thinking.
Yeah, I mean, the last time that it's been that full. So a huge win for the Colonels. And I truly think that Brandon Valley is a sneaky team.
And don't
discount them when it comes time to play some postseason state tournament basketball.
Brandon Valley also takes on Harrisburg on Saturday. That'll be a big game, the 2-3 game. Boys Class A, same as last week. Sioux Falls Christian, Hamlin, Pine Ridge, Dakota Valley, Sioux Valley.
I don't got much there.
Boys Class B, now this one is interesting. Three teams receiving first place votes. Castlewood barely sits at the number one. White River sitting at 2, DeSmit with 3, Weston Springs at 4, Howard jumps into the number 5 spot in the media poll. In our opinion, we thought White River should be 1.
Yeah, I have always said that White River should be 1 since the beginning of the season. As long as they can stay consistent, I think they'll run away with it, but I just think that their shooting is so much better than any of these teams. But you look at, I mean, the team that sticks out to me the most, Howard obviously jumping up in the top 5 after receiving votes last week. But Viberg Hurley is not a bad basketball team. And
no.
If they make it into the state tournament, nobody's going to want to play them. So
absolutely
I think that's
not
a sneaky team.
That's another one, too. And I think Leola Frederick area as well. They've lost once this year, I believe, between them and Springs. Now, you probably could argue, you know, strength of schedule and things like that, but a lot of solid teams in Class B should be wide open and pack the Barnett Arena or Barnett Center, right, up in Aberdeen?
Yeah.
Yeah, there we go. Let's move over to the girls' side. Two out of these three classes, this is the final media poll, as AA, O'Gorman 1, Mitchell 2, Brandon Valley 3, Jefferson 4, and Pier jumps up to number 5.
Don't quote me on this, but I believe O'Gorman and Mitchell play this week yet.
Friday.
So 1 versus 2, which pretty much decides it all.
I would say so. Moved on to Class A again. This is the final media poll. Flandreau 1. Not exactly sure how to say number 2. Formerly Red Cloud, number 2. Sioux Falls Christian, 3. Sisseton, 4. T Area, 5. Wagner, Vermilion, and Belle Fouche receiving votes. Not sure who put the last one in there, but I got a good guess.
Well, Cole, I think of the 8 teams receiving votes here, I think only 6 of them will make the state tournament. Maybe 5.
I'd say 5 as well.
That's all I got.
Maybe 6. You never know. Class B, Centerville 1, Ethan 2, Harding County 3, Arlington 4, Wall 5, Lyman just snubbed out of the top 5. There are 3 votes short. Freeman and Warner receiving votes as well. Watch out for Freeman in the state tournament.
Yeah, no kidding. Some real firepower there. I think Ethan played a little bit closer game on Tuesday than they'd like to as well. So, pretty cool Class B girls set up right now. I don't have much else to say, Cole. One thing that I think is to note, or at least a question I have for you, is of the 6 classes of basketball, boys and girls, which state tournament do you think will be the most fun to watch?
I think you just default to boys B, don't you? Right?
That?
It's always packed. For some reason, the games are always close. And if they're not close, they're really entertaining. I think I default to the boys B's.
That was my number one, but my 1B, if you will, I'm going to give it to Class A girls, because
that is true.
The Sodex 16 in Class A girls is going to be wild.
Yep. There's going to be a lot of interesting scores coming out of the Sodex 16, if I think.
Upset alert on everybody.
Even regions, too.
Oh, yeah.
There's some regions that aren't safe right now.
No. So, Cole, we have... Okay, we have time. Let's talk about some brackets of the Class A and B girls that were played first round on Tuesday night.
Yep. So I'm just going to start with B Region 1 and work my way up. B Region 1, the top 4 seeds made it. If you want me to list all the actual teams, I don't think I'm going to do that. B Region 2, the only upset was Iroquois Lake Preston upsets Castlewood, the 5-4 game, on a banked-in 3 at the buzzer. Now, the clip was shared by 605 Sports and it brought my attention, as the scoreboard said at one point it was 74 to 40-something, and the clock was counting down in 2 different spots, and the text I received was, thank goodness for live ticket, because they would have had the scoreboard right. We move on to Region 3, as Chester Area upsets Del Rapids St. Mary, a game that I did not see. Also, I'm not sure where you got the Ethan at a close game. They didn't play on Tuesday.
Oh, yeah, my bad. I was thinking something way different.
Yeah, you were. That's all right. I forgive you. It's been a week. Let's put it that way. 55-39 was that score. Chester Area over Del Rapids St. Mary.
That was the game that I thought was close. Yeah. Okay, there we go.
Yep.
Because at the half, it was really close.
Region 4, all the top 4 seeds made it in. We move on to Region 5B, all the top 4 seeds made it in as well.
Nuts in Region 6.
Region 6B is all over the place. Highmore Herald upsets Falkton Area, the 7-2 matchup, 54-44. And Potter County upsets Sully Buttes in the 5-4 matchup, 62-50. So it'll be number 1 against number 5 and number 7 against number 3 in Region 6B.
Wow.
That's about all I have to say about that as well. Region 7, to nobody's surprise, top 4 seeds. And Region 8, Timber Lake upsets Wakpala 60-53. So 1-5-2-3 in girls Region 8B. We move on to the girls Class A. Starting with Region 1, the 1-4 seeds made it in. No surprise there. In Region 2, the 1-4 seeds made it in there. In Region 3, the 1-4 seeds made it in there. In Region 4, the 1-4 seeds made it in there. In Region 5, the 1-4 seeds made it in there as well.
Give me another.
In Region 6, the 1-4 seeds made it in there as well. In Region 7, now hold your horses.
Yep.
Lakota Tech upsets Bennett County, the 5-4 matchup, 69-42.
To be honest, I thought Lakota Tech was going to win the game anyways.
Yeah, that I don't know why they're seated so low. Oh, probably because they're 8-11, I guess.
Yeah.
But, yeah,
They played some pretty tough opponents, though.
That is true. Yeah, I figured Lakota Tech should have won that one. And in the 6-3 matchup, Todd County upset Little Wound, 55-53. So Todd County will travel to Winter, and Lakota Tech will travel to Red Cloud. In Region 8, shocker, the top four seeds made it in, 1-4, 2-3. Looking at your mock SODAC 16 matchups for Girls A, you'd have Sisseton against Garrettson, Sioux Falls Christian Miller, Flandreau Hill City, Wagner Winter, Vermilion, Belle Fouche, Red Cloud, Mobridge Pollock, Aberdeen, Roncalli, Florence Henry, and T Area Parkston. That is assuming that the top seeds win every game in the finale of the region. Moved on to Girls B for a second in the mock matchups there. Arlington against Leola Frederick Area, Hardin County against Coleman Egan, Centerville against Fulton Area, Ethan against Avon, Wall against Freeman. If that happens, I kind of want to watch that game. Give me Freeman. Warner against White River. Lyman against James Valley Christian and Weston Springs against Lemon. Any further thoughts on the current playoff picture?
Not that I've already spoken about. I think that should be a very, very fun Thursday night across the state. I'm going to throw it out there right now. I think we have between the two classes of A and B girls, I think we're going to have 6 total upsets as far as seeds go.
I'm probably in the boat of 4, not quite 6, but there's going to be a couple, especially if you include both sides of it. Again, last round of regions is Thursday. The boys will finish up their seasons on Friday and Saturday. Then we have boys region quarterfinals, or first round of regions, Monday, Tuesday. Wednesday's off, church day. Thursday, the girls, SODAC 16, in all 3 classes, I believe, right?
I think so.
Friday will be the second round, or the final round, of the boys regions. And then that following Tuesday will be the boys SODAC 16, then Thursday, Friday, Saturday state tournament for girls, and the next Thursday, Friday, Saturday state tournament for boys. Very exciting times in the South Dakota high school sports scene.
A lot of ball to be played.
I think I saw a tweet by our good pal Ryan Deal that said something along the lines of 203 basketball games this week, with over 100 of them being playoff games. And he said, bring it on, I believe.
A lot of teams about to go home. That is for sure.
True. That is very, very true.
Look at us being on time, Cole.
Hey, there's a first time for anything, but remember what happened last.
Yeah, let's just start now then.
Might as well. We're going to move on to a new segment. The South Dakota High School Activities Association released their proposed athletic alignments for the 2024-25 and the 2025-26 seasons. And if you did not know, the alignments and the classifications go based off of every 2 years is when they switch. So once they're set, they say the same for 2 years again. The board of directors have to hear this for the first time on their meeting on the, I believe, 28th. And the second hearing is in early April. So we'll just kind of go down the list here. Again, in basketball, both boys and girls, T Area moves up to Class AA. which will make it an even 20 teams. They adjusted the line for A and B basketball, so bear with me here for a moment. Britain Hecla and Scotland Menow will move up into Region A. Moving down to, did I say Region A? Class A.
You're talking basketball here?
Basketball.
Yep.
This is basketball. Girls and boys. I believe they're the same for both. I'm just assuming. Moving down from Class A to Class B, Teos Pazina, Wabe Summit, Esteline Hendricks, Sanborn Central Woonsocket, Parkston, Kimball White Lake, North Central, Bennett County, Dupree, and McLaughlin. So 10 teams moving down, 2 moving up based on the new numbers and the new classification line. So basically the way you slice it, 8 regions still in both classes, 7 teams per region in Class A, 10 teams per region in Class B. Makes sense. Have it all even for all the regions. None of this. Some regions have 9 and some have 7. I mean, that's just ridiculous. Most notably, in Region 3A, Flandreau will move to 3A. Now, in Region 4A, arguably, and not really arguably, most undoubtedly, the toughest region in the state in both boys and girls basketball. Formerly, it was Beresford, Canton, Dakota Valley, EPJ, Lennox, Vermilion, T, and Parker. Well, T is moving up to AA, so that subtracts 1. So now you have 7, right? That makes the most sense. You have 7 in your class? No. Let's move Parker to Region 5 because they're the furthest west school. And let's move Sioux Falls Christian from Region 3 to Region 4. You know how insane, first of all.
Cole, no. Now, before you get on to this, I'd like to say that this is all proposed, and this can be contested.
It's going to be,
I'd assume, because of the fact that you have teams in Class B or Class A boys and Class A girls basketball who, I mean, I'd say this year and probably the past 6 years, 3 of the teams or more could have made the state tournament or the SODAC 16 in particular from this region.
And they didn't make it out of the region. That's how tough it is. I mean, we're looking at this year, too. As we just about had Dakota Valley, just think about this, Dakota Valley just about upset Lennox, and Lennox just about didn't make it.
This is going to bring forward an even greater movement for the SODAC 32.
Yep.
This is what will happen if this happens. But, Cole, before we go any further and talk about football, because we will do that next.
We will, trust me.
I think it is very important to note the new adjustment that was made that aligns with free and reduced meals.
Yep.
Because that also has a very large play in this.
Yes, it does.
So, notice how Scotland Menow came up.
Yep.
Notice, I mean, that's a big one to me. Notice how T area went up. Look at that community.
I'll just preface this by saying T area had planned to go up regardless, just because their enrollment number was getting so big. That's why this year and a little bit of last year they played so many double A teams, was to get ready for what they knew was going to be the eventual jump up.
And then also take note of this. Notice that Teal Spazino went down, Wabe Summit went down, Bennett County, Dupree, and McLaughlin went down. Now, when the numbers come out, which I'm pretty sure the numbers will get, I know the numbers get posted after everything gets set in stone.
Yep.
On how all the math was figured out.
Yep.
And who goes where as far as numbers. I'm very interested to see the math on this because I know a heck of a lot of time was spent on this and a bunch of minds spent a lot of time trying to figure this whole thing out.
Yep.
That the thing that is a kicker to me in the most detrimental way is how big of a change is this going to make over multiple years? Because right now, you know, it doesn't look too bad, you know. I mean, just looking at it, the one thing that kind of is interesting to me is seeing Parkston go down, but I've been told the past few years that they're going to go down.
And in about 4 years, they're going to go back up.
Right.
Because their elementary classes are big.
That, but does the free and reduced meal plan affect them? Because you've been to the Parkston community.
Right.
It's a pretty nice community. I've been in 90% of the houses in Parkston, believe it or not. I'm serious.
Yeah, you have.
Because I installed fiber optics, but those are some nice houses, man.
Yeah.
They're I mean, I would say, well, especially in the new development in the south side of town, there's some nice stuff.
Yeah.
So it's interesting that that happened. And how do those numbers reflect with what they wouldn't be without the free and reduced meal? That's all I have for that. And then when we look at football, it'll be another point to bring it back up.
Yeah, it will be. So they have proposed that Sioux Falls Christian will move to 4A. Again, a lot of the regions, from what I understand, are location-based. But if they were to pass that, you're going to have 7 unhappy schools, at least.
Even Sioux Falls Christian.
Well, yeah. They don't want to look at their region this year. And both, I mean, not really boys. I mean, you can probably take it because it's an outlier and blah, blah, blah. But Sioux Falls Christian girls were one of 2 teams that were above 500 in the region this year, if I'm not mistaken. That's above 500. Region 4A, 7 out of the 8 teams were above 500. So take that as you will. That is the proposed basketball alignments. Also, one thing I'd like to note, in case my parents are listening, Mount Vernon Plankington is proposed to move up to Class A for golf. And you know what that means? Class A golf is a fall sport.
Oh.
Yeah.
Dino's not going to be able to play football.
Yeah. Or I don't know what is going to happen. I know at one point, Karst had wanted us to move up to A because it's better competition and closer meets.
Yeah, I suppose.
And better quality courses and things like that, but it's in the fall.
Could get cold.
So that's the deal. That's what I really don't understand with these golf alignments. I didn't even know there were regions in golf, I guess. I mean, we played a region meet every year, but it seemed like the teams are always different. You have to be able to, I think you almost have to confirm that with the school and say, are you okay with this sport moving to a different season? Because that is, I don't know.
So, a couple things. I'd just like to point out right now that volleyball reflects identically to basketball girls and boys. So, volleyball is the same. And I'm looking at wrestling here. And the only change is Sisseton's going to go down to Class B, which is very notable. And I believe Flandreau also goes down to Class B. And maybe even, Baltic goes down to Class B as well. Madison and Milbank jump up to Class A wrestling.
How is Canton not Class A?
Colt, you're one of many folks who have been asked this question, the age-old question.
Oh, boy.
And then the last thing I'll leave you with before we get on to football here is, do you think that Sioux Falls Christian petitions up to Class AA?
No.
Just because they don't want to play in this region?
No. They'll stay A.
They'd be better to do it, really.
Yeah, I understand that, but they would...
I think, Larsch, in our lifetime, Sioux Falls Christian will be playing AA basketball and AA football very soon. I mean, they're playing Mitchell competitively.
Yeah.
They beat Mitchell competitively years ago.
Yeah.
They're a competitive Class 11A football team right now.
Yep.
And think about their volleyball team. I mean, dude, they've smoked teams for years.
It's been unbelievable. What, 6 straight?
Yeah. I mean, so I think they might honestly be better to petition up. But I know they probably won't yet. But they got to be getting close.
That is a good point.
They got to be getting close.
That is a really good point, I guess.
Because O'Gorman did it, remember? O'Gorman wasn't right. Always a AA.
Right.
They had to do it because, I mean, I wouldn't call it, I mean, selection, if you will, but I mean, more of a population thing, but they went up anyways.
Right.
Because it's the right thing to do. You look at O'Gorman's population versus Sioux Falls, Washington, Lincoln, Roosevelt, and whoever else. It's a lot less.
Yeah.
Does Christian do it? I don't know.
You make a good point, I guess. I never really thought of it that way. I think they do at some point.
Some point, yes.
Yeah.
In our lifetime, for sure.
Oh, yeah. All right, now let's move on to football, as we found ourselves a little bit behind schedule. That's okay. That don't matter.
Look at
us. Tavin doesn't care. Proposed football alignments for 24-25 and 25-26 seasons. Again, at any point, if you want to call in with your opinions, 605-658-6813.
Do your best to make it clean would be preferred, too.
Yeah, please no swearing unless you want to pay the $35,000 fine or something like that. All right, here's the changes. 11AA, no changes. 11A, no changes. Or 11AAA and AA, no changes, excuse me. 11A, Rapid City Christian and Tri-Valley move up from B to A.
Yeah, two teams that were very competitive this year in Class 11B, yeah. Cole, and they have some really great young future players ahead of them. I had a chance to do Tri-Valley this year, and I watched a couple of Rapid City Christian games. Tri-Valley's got some really good young dudes.
Yeah,
and
they do.
Rapid City Christian's got some really good young good dudes as well. So that's tough for them to go up, and I don't know how bad they want to go up.
Well, an eye for an eye as Beresford and Chamberlain move from A to B.
Yeah, Beresford coming back down to 11B, Cole.
Wow.
Yeah. Your high school career oust by Beresford.
Yep.
They were
shouldn't have been, but that's okay.
Yeah, long story. but no, that's very interesting that they come back down.
I'm
very surprised. I figure their population, and this is Beresford, a community that I thought would be negatively affected by the free and reduced lunch thing.
Yeah.
Because I thought that it would make them stay in 11A for sure.
That's what I thought too.
Chamberlain makes sense.
Yep.
But Beresford, that is something that is very interesting to me.
Yeah, it is. We move down to 9AA as there's almost more new teams than there are remaining teams. So it splits out. There's 9AAA, 11 in AA, 14 in A, 24 in 11B, 23 apiece in each 9-man class. New to 9AA this year, DeSmet, Gregory, Hill City, New Underwood, Redfield, Scotland Menlo, Trip Down on Armor, Andy, Central Dakota Christian, and Wabe Summit. 8 new teams.
Yeah, so some teams coming down from Class 11B. Hill City, Redfield, Scotland Menlo, TDA, ACDC, and Wabe Summit.
Yep.
Cole, I think who benefits the most from this is TDA, ACDC, and Scotland Menlo.
Yeah.
Because of the young core that they have coming up, because we know, at least in the area personally, they got some good kids.
Yep.
So this is huge for them.
Yeah,
but
it is.
This is essentially a shell of what 9AA was for the past, what, 6-8 years-ish?
Yeah.
It's totally different.
Yep.
And I have something to talk about when we get to Class 9B, too. But DeSmet coming up does not surprise me. This is one direct correlation to the free and reduced lunch thing, 100%,
yeah.
In my opinion.
Yep.
In my opinion, when the numbers come out, this is going to be...
Yeah, it'll be a good talking point when the numbers come out. I'm sure it'll be after all this is approved and things like that. As we take a look down to 9A, holy cow, where do we start? Dupree, Gayville Vaughan, Howard, Ipswich, Lemon McIntosh, North Central, Platte Geddes, Potter County, Wall, and White River. 10 new teams to 9A this year.
9A is going to be fun.
Yeah, it is. It usually is. But it's going to be even more now.
I mean, it's going to make it difficult to make a run because Platte Geddes has got a really good group of kids coming up. Wall always has some great kids coming up. Potter County. Potter County going back down to 9A.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
That's crazy.
And Gabe O'Vallon even being down there. I mean, they're going to throw a team together. They have some good young kids as well. It's going to make it really difficult for teams like Centerville, Alcester Hudson, Castlewood, Chester, and like Dubrook, who was in the state championship this year, to even make a close to a run next
year. Yep.
But as we know, Class 9A playoffs are always nuts. So
you never know who's going to win out of them. We move down to 9B. Some new teams and some even new towns that are offering football this year, as Burke, Canastota, Coleman Egan, Iroquois Lake Preston, Newell, Northwestern, and Oldham Ramona Rutland move into 9B. New schools offering football for one of them the first time. Sioux Falls Lutheran and Wilmot offering football now. As I believe Wilmot, they had it.
Years ago, I believe.
Yeah, right. So two brand new teams of SDHSAA football.
Notably here at Canastota going down to 9B.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
Wow.
And Coleman Egan finally back to 9B.
Yep.
They're going to be a team to look out for years to come.
Yeah, they are.
I remember when we had some friends, Taylor Creech, Merle Creech, remember all the Creeches we used to camp with? And Cole was the team, or he had a great team. There was some really good players on that team. They actually beat Warner in the Dome that year in Class 9B.
Yeah.
But when they're 9B, man, that's a scary, scary sight to see Coleman Egan back in Class 9B. And then we go one more team down, Cologne.
Right.
You're going to try to throw a team together. But now that alignments are out, Cole, do you think if they can pull it off that Cologne and Winter try to re-co-op or try to make a co-op work now that the alignments are out?
I think that now the different numbers are out. But here's the problem with that, though, is Winter's so close to moving up to A anyway, and a lot of people think they should be A based on the size. I even think that no matter, even if it's one ADM that Cologne offers, it's going to be, they're going to bump up. And I think that was their biggest concern is that no matter how many or how few players that Cologne has, they're going to bump up to 11A.
But, I mean, with a co-op, and I'm kind of reeling myself in here a little bit, if you will. With a co-op, I don't know that you can submit a co-op to the state and have it confirmed after this is posted. I don't know if that's possible.
Maybe it is, maybe it isn't. I don't know.
It's tough to say. I think it'd be very tough for a co-op to work like that. But if it's even remotely possible, I think Cologne wants to get with Winter.
Well, they already do.
Right, and absolutely. But Winter is not having it because they don't want to go play 11A football.
Viewer text, Wilmont, they were co-opted with Wabe Summit.
That's right.
They were Dakota. They were previously the Dakota Hills co-op, and they split. Wabe Summit is AA, and Wilmont 9B.
Right. So Wabe Summit really didn't want to play 11B football.
Yeah.
You know?
Yep. Another viewer text, Winter has no interest in the co-op due to jumping to 11A.
Yeah. Well, right. That's obvious.
Don't you think, now this is hypothetical, and we're pretty behind and kind of off topic here, but wouldn't they dominate 11A too?
I think so. I mean,
because didn't they play? They played West Central this year, right?
Yeah, I did the
and
game.
Beat them.
Or no, I didn't do the game. No, I did not do the game.
No,
Jody did the game.
Yeah,
and
it was freezing cold, and the wind was right into their mics, and you couldn't hear the announcers. Too bad, but
so, and they dominated. We watched that in your room. That's why.
Yeah,
I remember
we did.
It. We watched that
we
in
did.
Your room, and just a domination.
Yeah.
But, Cole, I mean, if you're good enough, you really should move up. I mean,
well, it's probably the same argument with from Winter moving to 11A to Sioux Falls Christian moving to Class AA. Why move when you're dominating, right?
Yeah.
I mean, there's that aspect to it. Now, whether they should or shouldn't move up, that's a whole another topic.
All right, Cole, that pretty much wraps that segment up, I think.
Yeah, it does. I think it does.
Well, we're only 7 minutes behind schedule.
Hey, no big deal.
We gotta get this thing going here.
This is nothing compared to some shows. Anyway.
Again, if you want to call in real quick, Cole, if you want to call into the CharCole Sports Show, the KAOR line is 605-658-6813 to call into the CharCole Sports Show. One more time, that number to call into the CharCole Sports Show, 605-658-6813. Cole, have at it.
All right, final topic of the day before we get to the picks of the week, as it was recently published in a Facebook post by Superintendent Athletic Director, Boys Basketball Coach of the Mount Vernon Plankton Titans, Eric Denning, as he was basically describing, see if I can't pull it up here so I know what I'm talking about. It was a very long post, but I thought it was a good post as well. It was titled, Embracing the Spirit of Community, A Call to Attend High School Sports Events. Very well written, might I add, as well. And it was pretty much, to sum it up, is he believes, now I believe this is probably an accurate statement, that attendance for sporting events is going down. You could argue across the state, maybe it's individualized, and you could also probably argue that entire thing. And he basically tried to list some factors, and eventually at one point it said that live streaming is a great thing to have, but maybe sometimes it's saying people are rather staying at home than going to the games. Anyway, that's, again, go to the Mount Vernon School District Facebook page, go to his Facebook page. You can see the entire post in its entirety. I have nowhere near enough time to read it all out loud, but I do have it up in front of me. And then I lost it for a second. So, Charlie, I give you the floor for a minute or so, or honestly, as long as you want to take. If you want to take 11 minutes, go ahead. Your thoughts First of all, do you believe that attendance for high school events is going down? Yes, no. What may be some reasons, and is what would you say, if it is true, what do you say is the main reason? The floor is yours.
Yeah, Cole, I think I'll point this out first before I get into what I have to say. I think the execution of this was done very well. I think the execution of this...
I agree.
Do you want to call it a letter, if you will, or more of a...
I'd say it's formatted like a letter.
I think it is, too, because he writes sincerely at the end. So, and he signs in as well. But I think the execution of the letter was done to perfection. I think he got his word out to a large number of individuals, and a lot of individuals end up getting to see this. And in result, there was both positive and negative against this. Now, I think after reading it, he called a few factors out, as you mentioned, and a few things got caught in the crossfire of that as well, which comes with that type of stuff. And I think it's a very important thing to look at as far as what derives this, you know, what caused this. And so I think that's one thing, and I'll let folks, you know, think for themselves and put their own thinking cap on of what makes a person write this. And obviously the title of it is A Call to Attend High School Sporting Events. Well, let's kind of read between the lines here, if you will, Cole. Obviously I think, being able to go to a high school sporting event is one of the greatest things our state has to offer. It's fascinating. We have some of the greatest venues in the world, the Corn Palace, specifically the Denny. The Denny is awesome.
Yeah, it is.
Obviously the Barnett Center up in Aberdeen. We have some of the premier facilities in this state to attend sporting events. Now, all of our state, every single basketball game that this state has to offer can be found somewhere, whether it's a telecast or a radio broadcast or somewhere in between. Games can be found.
Yep.
As far as ease of use. Now, does that reflect the great venues that we have? And I'm not going to draw back to the venues for everything, because we have some great local gyms as well. But I'm saying, what draws a person to go to a basketball game, Cole? Is it just the having a horse in the race? Is that where you want to go? And you got a kid or a relative or a friend or a buddy maybe going to the game? Is that what it is? Or is it you want to go actually truly watch the game because you love, love, love basketball, or you love, love, love football or volleyball? And here's how I want to phrase this. I think that we can call this out, you know, we can speak about how it's important to go to games, and maybe it is. You know, I remember thinking back to when we were kids, how we'd go watch White River in the Corn Palace, or we'd go watch Dakota Wesleyan in the Corn Palace. Cole, but think about this. The game was also on TV.
Yeah.
The game was on TV. The game was on the radio. We had the best stinking radio guy in the history of South Dakota on the radio waves and local radio.
Yep.
Listen to it every Wednesday. Every Wednesday night we listened to this thing if we couldn't go to the game. But we were there. We showed up.
Yep.
Because they were fun to watch.
Yeah.
So I think that has a large part of it. And having a horse in the race is a big part of it, too, to getting people to go to games. And I understand that maybe, and this is probably the last thing you want to talk about, is the cost to get into the game. But, I mean, that's neither here nor there, because I don't think money's a factor. I think the Activities Association brings enough money in itself. But the biggest thing that I think was missed in this letter was a call to all events in general, because, you know, as we spoke about, being called out was specifically streaming services or radio broadcasts or that ability to watch an activity or an event.
Yep.
I think what was missed is the culmination of this in it's not just athletics. It is the ease of use to watch an athletic event, a fine arts event, a graduation, a coronation, a prom, grand march.
Everything.
It is easy to do if you can't make it. But hey, I mean, we're not going to force you to go, and that's pretty much all I got here. That's everything I wanted to say in a nutshell. So,
again, if you want to share your opinions on the Charcole Sports Show, here's the phone number. I'll say it twice. 605-658-6813. That again, 605-658-6813 is the phone line. Or keep texting us your thoughts. You know, Charlie, we're in an interesting position.
I know.
In this, as this is done by, at one point, both of our alma maters, by a guy we know very well. But it's also interesting because we're now in the live streaming business. And there's a lot of different angles I could take on this. And I think one thing that I want to hit on is that this was a very good letter, and there's a lot of very good things on it.
I think the execution of this letter was
very good,
like a 10 out of 10.
And as somebody who's known Denning for all my life, I know he's very good at writing these types of things. I want to be careful with what I say here. I don't want to burn too many bridges here. Is it the ease of access? Yes. But I think this also comes into kind of what you touched on as well, is it's a bigger picture. And I think that's kind of what we're missing here, is it's not just this one reason for why people aren't showing up. And you kind of hit on it as well.
Yeah, I hit a bunch of different
reasons. Do you
have
a horse in the race? I mean, are you even interested? And I think a lot of it goes back to people have a lot going on. Like
in today's age, absolutely.
And if you don't have a direct horse in the race, for example, like if you don't have a relative that's playing or something like that, and say even, for example, it's a 15-minute drive both ways. You know, it's half an hour out of your day when you could be cooking for your family or doing this and that or whatever. And he kind of – Denning actually went on our favorite radio show out west and kind of talked about it briefly, and – you kind of reminiscing on the old days and say, well, when you think about the old Hanson Classic, I mean, it used to be so full, and for the matinee games, they'd shut the doors and not let anybody in. Well, when you think about that, let's just say, for example, 15 years ago, there was a lot less to do 15 years ago than there is now. Is that the main reason? No. Is it one of the reasons? Yes, I'd say. So it's... And... So that's... That's probably one of the main reasons why this is, you could possibly argue this is declining, both regular events, region events, state events.
So would you say, I think what you're trying to say is there was a culture change, is what you're saying, as far as people being busy?
I would say so. There had to been, well, here's my logic behind this, is this feels way too sophisticated to just say this is just a simple, oh, people don't want to go to the games anymore.
I mean, I did, and I'm sure most of, or not most of, but a few of our listeners right now got a chance to see a post that was made on Twitter yesterday about a pretty well-attended basketball game.
Yeah.
So I know when there are teams, I mean, and I'll even go back to our childhood, because I want to make a personal connection to the folks listening at home, and even if there's folks listening here in Vermilion, they can make a connection to it. In our childhood, Cole, how many Dakota Wesleyan basketball games did we go to? More than we can count.
Three quarters of them.
More than we can count. We would go and pack the place.
Yeah.
I remember on any given Wednesday night, even folks would travel from Morningside, Dort, I mean, wherever. Oh,
yeah. That was the best part about sitting in the bleachers, because the people in front of you were the away fans.
Yeah. And we had no horse in the race. We had, I mean, maybe you guys were team makers. I mean, you guys still are team makers, aren't you?
I think so, yeah.
So you were team makers, so maybe there's a horse in the race there. But other than that, you have no horse in the race, but what you had is interest. You wanted to go to the games.
Yeah.
How bad do you want to go watch a basketball game is the question. You and I are probably different than your average person. Because,
very much.
Because you and I go to random USD games just on the usual.
Yeah, and I'm working about 90% of them too.
Right.
Like if I tallied up right now, I'm probably just about 85 basketball games for the year. Been at, worked at.
Just a
well,
few.
Well, just worked at. I just mean, Bennett, that's probably even more. But here's the deal, and you say what you want first, because I might go on a little bit of a rant.
No, that's good. Just before you get into your little whatever you got, if you want to call in, we got about 5 minutes left here on the show. We can run a little long if we need to, but we'd prefer not to. To call into the CharCole Sports Show, 605-658-6813 if you want to call into the CharCole Sports Show and drop any comment, question, concern in regards to this or anything, particularly this.
Right.
But, Cole, the floor is yours here.
You know, this comes back to, as I just saw Tav in Atlanta walk by, as it kind of reminded me of, I feel like we just had this exact conversation, except it was with USD. So this shows me, now I'm not a great scientist. I had a great science teacher. I'm not a very good scientist. But just logical reasoning shows me that this is just a bigger issue than a localized high school sports issue. Right? Because we had the stats in front of us for USD games, and we've got our eyeballs for high school games.
But again, how much, and we said it that day too. I mean, pretty much what we're saying today is what we refer to in a different show.
Pretty much.
But what we said that day is the quality of our team playing a big part or a factor in that, Cole?
That's one thing that we really did not get into that we very easily could have is the like we see in the Corn Palace. As you look at the girls' team, they've been okay past years. Now they're good this year. The boys' team, there was a stretch there where they were terrible. And they slowly built back. And now it was a double head. No, was it just boys' game? It was just a boys' game, right?
What's that?
The Mitchell game on yesterday. Was it a double header or just one game? I can't remember. Anyway, you have two good Colonels teams packing the Corn Palace. I think that definitely plays an issue. I said I wasn't going to burn the bridge, but whatever. Who cares? Okay, this may be one of the issues, but this is not the main issue by any means, is the live streaming. Now, here I put on my company shirt and my company jacket and things like that, but it's more of an ease of access, and one thing I've noticed is doing a lot of Vermillion games is you get a lot of viewers that'll type in the chat and say, oh, I'm watching my niece or nephew from wherever I am in the United States, or like we saw with amateur baseball too. As I'm going to answer the phone here in a second.
Yeah, I'll answer. You turn them on.
Okay.
Welcome to the CharCole Sports Show. What do you got for us today?
Hey, I got a couple comments on this last topic.
Yes,
all right?
Yes, sir. Yeah, what do you got?
I know I attend a lot of sporting events every year, and nobody can use like the state competitions as examples of lower attendance. You know, like the state bees in Aberdeen.
Right.
But on average, during the year, the attendance is down.
Oh, yeah.
And many comments I've heard is people say, I've just watched it on TV. You know? And it's a great tool to have. It's fantastic. I love it. I love being able to watch three games and attend one game. You know, at the end of the day. But I'm going to leave you with one quote. In a small school, people say they don't know the kids anymore, so they don't go to events. And that is so far from the case. What's wrong is you don't know the kids because you don't attend the events.
Yeah, that is very true.
You understand that?
I appreciate you calling in, and I definitely align with a lot of what you say. And I think what's important, and I'm glad that he brought it up, was we didn't take into account the small school scale of things and how different that is. You know what I'm saying, Cole?
Right.
So,
and one thing that I was going to kind of touch on too is, as Tavin, can we run like 5 minutes late? I don't know. Are the speakers on out there?
I don't know.
Are the speakers on out there? Can we go like 5 minutes late? Yeah, he doesn't care.
Let's go like 3 minutes late.
Hopefully won't be five. But yeah, one thing you talk about too is like the small town aspect of it and these towns that are co-opt. And I am going to hang up the phone. I just realized I did not do that yet. But I kind of touched on it earlier with the travel. Say, let's take for example the Kimball White Lake co-op. Okay? They're about, what, 10, 15 minutes apart? Say the game's at Kimball, and you live 10 minutes east of White Lake. That's now a just about an hour round trip for you on what I might add is one of the worst stretches of road possible in old Highway 16.
Mm-hmm.
Is it's just one of the things is, I don't know where I was really going with this except for the travel part of it.
Well, I think the point of him bringing up the point or the thing that he brought up that really, I mean, his quote at the end, obviously, knowing the kids is a huge part of it, but you have to, you know, go to those games to know the kids as well.
Yeah.
But in an age of social media, which we're going to bring it back to social media and mass media here,
yep,
it's hard not to know everybody because you're all connected by the internet. So it's hard to say you don't know.
But that brings up a whole different topic is, do you know them on social media or do you know them in
person?
Yeah,
I know.
That's a big difference.
I know.
I also just like to note the caller texted and said that he 100% agrees with the article that was posted. He just liked that mentioned out there. So, anyway, please continue.
No, yeah, that's pretty much all I got to say on this. And I think the article was executed very nicely.
So. Yeah, it was. And I'll just wrap it up by saying this. As I feel like just a couple weeks ago, 3 weeks ago, we had this exact conversation with Tavin about USD attendance and how it's been dropping. And I, again, that just leads me to believe there's more than one issue at play. And it's almost, like you said, kind of a culture change.
I know. We should have got you on John Thayer's radio show to talk about our little
we could've.
Comments that night. But
yeah, we could have. Anyway, I think it's definitely more than just a one-topic issue. And, I mean, we kind of talked about it when we talked about USD, how much does the pandemic play into it? And the fact that we cut off a school year and then we kind of got back and a lot of schools were limiting in attendance. So that's when live streaming became prevalent. And yeah, I just, maybe times have changed. Did they change in a good way or a bad way? We're going to have to find out, I guess, right?
I'm going to leave you with a statistic, and we got to get into our picks of the week. We broke records this year as far as Super Bowl viewership.
Yeah.
And I think it'll only get to be greater.
Yeah.
People want to watch online and not go to the games. And the Super Bowl's a whole thing in itself because
yeah,
it's expensive
right.
to go
right.
to.
Right, $8,000 a ticket.
Yeah, and nuts. And it's not like that for a high school basketball game. There is something going on. I don't know if we can pinpoint it. We brought up a ton of different ideas.
We did.
I don't know if we can pinpoint one specifically, though.
I don't think we can either. It's just as, yeah, I don't know what the exact problem is. I don't think you can, like you said, I don't think you can pinpinpoint one thing.
All right, Cole.
All right, let's
try to get into our picks of the week here. You run through them quick. I'll do mine.
I'm 47-28, 62%. I'm down about 2%. I went 2-3 last week. You are 49-17, 74% winning rate. You went 5-1 last week on some cheesy picks, might I add. Here are my picks. Turn down music a little bit. There we go. High school basketball, girls, Thursday, T over EPJ, Freeman over Gayville Vaughan, O'Gorman over Mitchell. Big one there. Friday, boys, Dakota Valley over Lennox, Saturday, boys, Harrisburg over Brandon Valley. College basketball, tonight, Nebraska over Indiana. Tomorrow, Minnesota over Ohio State. And Saturday, Tennessee over Texas A&M. Book it.
Book it. I'm not sure if I would follow any of those picks, folks.
Yeah, probably not.
Maybe the only one that makes sense is the Freeman pick. But anyways, my picks this nice week tonight. I picked a Duke game that we'll get into, but I just want to say that game has been playing for an hour, and I have not seen the score yet. So, and this was in far before that. Anyways, high school basketball, I have Howard over Coleman Egan in girls basketball. I have Highmore Herald getting a huge upset over Harriet Selby area in girls basketball. Highmore Herald, I'm going to have a 7 seed making the Soda X 16 out of their region.
All right.
And then I have Hanson over Parkston in girls basketball. Not sure if it can happen, but I'm pulling for him anyways. And then in college basketball, I have Duke over Miami. That game is an hour and 4 minutes old now, and I have USD over Kansas City tomorrow, and I have USD over Oral Roberts on Saturday. Both those are men's games, Cole.
Thanks for tuning in. CharCole Sports Show. We'll be back next week, 6 to 7 p.m. on Wednesday. Charlie will be calling in. You can listen back to the episodes, podcastable, Apple, Spotify, anywhere you get your podcast. I'm Cole Larsch, Charlie Prien. Yeah, go ahead.
I would like to say good luck to all the wrestlers, state wrestling this weekend. That's one thing we didn't hit.
Very true. Tavern and Landon are next on 91.1 KAOR in Vermilion.